Let's start. We are running late by 1 minute. That's all right. So, we are with us, Ms. Neha Gupta from IIT Kharagpur. So, she is going to talk to us about the geometry described by the Mohr's action on matrix integrals, SL to R, on the space of dual numbers. Sneha, you have 20 minutes.
Good morning, everyone. The topic of my presentation is geometry described by the Mohr's action of SL to R on dual numbers using a Lanin program. So, first of all, I will give a quick introduction about my presentation. So, the most common hypercomplex number system that we all know is the system of hypercomplex numbers, which has an imaginary unit I such that I squared is equal to minus 1. So, in my talk, I will be discussing another hypercomplex number system, which is the system of dual numbers that has the dual unit epsilon such that epsilon squared is equal to 0. So, these numbers were developed in the year 1873 by William Clifford. They are also called numbers of paranoid type, and going to such a name, they are mathematically represented by the set RE, which is equal to the set of numbers of the form U plus epsilon V, where u, v are real numbers and epsilon square is equal to 0. Next, we have some properties of dual numbers. First is that dual numbers form a two-dimensional commutative ring over real numbers. Second is they have zero divisors, which are the set of a purely non-real dual numbers. That is, it is given by the set d is equal to numbers of the form epsilon v, where v is a real number. Now, to study the geometry which is associated with dual numbers, we will be making use of the technique, the Lanin program, which was developed by Felix Klein in the year 1872. According to which, geometry is described as those properties that we have invariant under a group of transformations. So, our work is really inspired by the work of Kissel, in which he has shown Mohr's action of SL to R on three spaces of complex, dual, and double numbers. Each term has elliptic, parabolic, and hyperbolic cases respectively. So we will be exploring more of the parabolic case and hypothetically various aspects of this geometry. So some definitions that I am using in my work are: first one is group action. So a group action of a group G on the set X is a map from G cross X to X, written as G dot X, such that the following two properties hold. Next is the orbit. So the orbit of an element X under a group action is given by the set G dot X, where G belongs to the group G. Next we have the isotropy subgroup. So the isotropy subgroup or stabilizer of an element X under a group action is the set of all elements G which fixes X. Next we have matrix Lie group. So a matrix Lie group is any subgroup G of the general linear group over complex numbers with the property that is AM is any sequence of matrices in G and AM converges to some matrix A, then either A belongs to G or A is not invertible. Next we have Mohr's transformation. So we define Mohr's transformation as a function phi from RP to RP, such that phi z is equal to az plus b by cz plus d, where ad minus bc is not equal to 0, and abcd are real numbers, and z is a dual number that is belongs to set R. Next, we have Evasova decomposition of SL to R. So if g is a semi-simple real Lie group, then by Evasova decomposition of g, any element of g can be written as a product of three elements, a, n, and k, belonging to closed subgroups A, N, and K of G, such that K is the maximal compact group, A is the simply connected abelian diagonal group of matrices, N is the nilpotent group of matrices, and K contains the center of G. So following Evasova decomposition, we can write SL to R in the form A, N, K, where A, N, and K are the following three sets. Next, our main problem is to study the geometry corresponding to the Mohr's action of SL to R on RP given by the function f from R to R B such that f z is equals to a z plus b by c z plus d, where z belongs to R B and the matrix A B C D belongs to S N to R. Next, we must study the action of the subgroups A, N, and K that we derive from the Kolsova decomposition of S N to R. So first, we have the action of A. So according to it, for any element belonging to R B, A defines dilation by the factor alpha square that fixes the origin. So these are the A orbits. Next, we have the action of K, under which for any element belonging to R P, N defines shifts along the u axis by u. So these are my N orbits. Next, we have the most important action given by the subgroup K. So we have the theorem that states a K orbit in R P passing through a point 0 t where t is greater than 0. That is, we are taking a point of the upper half plane, has the following equation. Now this equation is an upward facing parabola having vertex 0 t and focal length 1 by 4 t. So for the proof, we suppose if u v is a point which is lying on the k orbit that passes through 0 t, then to obtain u v, we will have to perform the Mobius action of an element of k on the point 0 t. So after performing the Mobius action, we will get the values of u and v given by equation number 2. Now, putting the values of u and v from the equation number 2, we can verify that the equation of the k orbit is u square equals to t inverse v minus t, which is an upward facing parabola that has vertex 0 t and focal length 1 by 4 t. So, depending on various values of t, these are the k orbits which we get. Next, we discuss the isotropic subgroup of epsilon, which is the dual unit. So, we have the theorem that states the isotropic subgroup of epsilon is the subgroup n dash of matrices given by the set n dash equals to the set containing matrices of the form 1, 0, mu, 1, where mu belongs to real numbers. Now, for the proof, again, we perform the Mobius action of an arbitrary element of n dash on epsilon and we check that it fixes epsilon. Hence, this is the n dash is the isotropic subgroup of epsilon. Next, we have the theorem that states the isotropic subgroup n dash is conjugate to the subgroup n, which we obtained from the Kolsova decomposition of S to R. Next, we have the theorem that states n dash fixes any point epsilon b on the vertical axis. Now, previously we had shown that numbers of the form epsilon b are the zero divisors of dual numbers. Therefore, the isotropic subgroup of epsilon fixes the zero divisors of dual numbers. Next, we have the theorem regarding the orbit of the isotropic subgroup n dash. So, the orbit is given by u square minus 2nb equals to 0, where n is a natural number. Now, these are parabolas having vertical axis b with focal length n by 2. The proof is quite similar to that we obtained in case of k orbit. So, let us suppose that u plus epsilon b belonging to Rp be an arbitrary point on the n dash orbit that passes through a plus epsilon b belonging to Rp, where b is not equals to 0. Then, to obtain u plus epsilon, the point u plus epsilon b, again we will perform the Mobius action of an element of n dash on a plus epsilon b. So, after doing the calculations, ultimately we will get the parabolic equation, which is u squared minus 2nb equals to 0, where 2n is equals to a squared by b. Now the form 2n is equals to a squared b, why we have taken such a form, this will be understood when we go to our cycles. So these are parabolas that have vertical axis b, vertex as the origin and focal length n by 2. So depending on various values of n, we have the n dash orbit given by the scale. Next we move to our cycles and then further we will go to FSC construction to show the various ingredient properties. Cycles. So, the cycle is basically a set of points u, v belonging to R2, which is defined in the parabolic case by the equation number 4, is ku square minus 2lu minus 2lv plus m equals to 0, where k, l, n, m belongs to real numbers and not all of them are 0. Now, in our case, we shall be using the term cycle to denote parabolas. Also, the the cyclic equation given by question number 4 can be completely determined by a point K L and M belonging to R4. Now for a scaling factor lambda not equals to 0, the point lambda K, lambda L, lambda N, lambda M, it defines an equivalent relation to 4. So whenever we see such kind of an equivalent relation, that is the relation of scalar multiplicity, projective space comes into our mind, because these lines are these points are on the same line. So we will prefer to consider the projective space PG, which is the set of equivalence classes of R4 minus the origin under the equivalence relation given by tilde for any non-zero real number lambda. So we will call PG as the cyclic space and refer to R2 as the point space. Next we have framework structure norms constructions. So in order to perform various operations on cycle, we will represent them in the form of a matrix, that is the numbers A, L, N, F that represents the cycle as we had seen previously. We will arrange them in the form of a matrix given by C sigma rep with a new hypercomplex unit epsilon rep. Now the values of sigma rep are minus 1, 0 or 1, and it is completely independent of the value of the dual unit. This matrix is called framework structure norms matrix, and it plays a very important role in connecting the cycle with Mobius action, as we will be seeing. Now we will use the following two notations. First is Q, which is the map that associates the point belonging to PG, a point PLNF, which that is the cycle space, to the cycle equation given by equation number 5. Next is we consider the notation M, which is the map that associates the point A, L, and M belonging to PG, the cycle space, to the space of 2 plus 2 matrices given by C, this equation number 6. Now this figure shows the correspondence between 5 and 6 through the bijection Q not M. So basically what we are trying to show is that this cycle, which we represented through equation number 5, can be equally well represented through the matrix given by C. That is, the matrix C is the valid representation of a cycle. Next, we come to the most important theorem of this part, that the image C tilde of a cycle C under Mobius transformation in RP with G belonging to SL2R is given by the similarity C tilde equals to GC G inverse. So in other words, framework structure norm construction is interpreting Mobius action on cycles with the linear map given by 7. So in a way, what we are doing is that the image C tilde, which we would have obtained by Mobius under the Mobius transformation in RP, we are getting the same image by performing a similarity operation. So in a way, our work becomes more convenient. Next, we will move towards the cyclic representation of the orbit of the isotropic subgroup M dash. So previously, we had deduced that the orbit of the isotropic subgroup of the dual unit epsilon is given by U squared minus 2nt equals to 0. We take it as equation number 8. Now, if we compare equation number 8 with equation number 4, that is this equation of the cycle. So then the cyclic representation of N dash orbit will be given by 1, 0, N, 0. Because in this case, A is equals to 1, L is 0, N is the same as before, and again M is 0. So this will be the cyclic representation of isotropic subgroup N dash, 1, 0, N, 0. Hence, the corresponding matrix representation will be given by C equals to epsilon rel N, 0, 1, epsilon rel N. So again over here, if we put the values of PL and F, we will get this matrix. Okay. So now we will proceed to obtain an invariant property of this cycle using matrices. So we have the lemma that states the cycles 1, 0, N, 0 are invariant under similarity with elements of the isotropic subgroup N dash. So we take an arbitrary element N belonging to N dash, and then we consider the matrix representation of the cycle 1, 0, N, 0 given by matrix C. Then we will perform the similarity action which was given by equation number 7 in this theorem. We will make use of this theorem and use equation number 7 to perform the mutual similarity. And after performing the operation, we see we are again getting the matrix C back. Hence, this cycle is invariant under the similarity operation. Next, we move towards some practical applications of the subgroup 10 and 10 dash. So, for coaxial optics, if two coaxial systems are aggregated one after the another, then the composite is described by the product of a transfer matrix which belongs to the N subgroup. So, mathematically, it can be described by the following equation, where we can see that the transfer matrix 1 T by N, 0 N, this belongs to the N subgroup. So, in a way, we are performing SN2R action, more precisely N action on the space of rays. Next, the linear relativity of classical mechanics. So, the coordinates of space time can be denoted by Tx belonging to R2, where T is the time component and X is the spatial component. Then, the Galilean relativity principle tells us that the laws of motion will be invariant under the shift of the reference point and the linear transformation given by the following equation, where the transformation matrix GV, the matrix 1, 0, V1, this belongs to the N dash subgroup. Next, concluding my presentation, I would like to mention a few points. So, the main inspiration behind our work was the Langmuir program. So, we took Möbius transformation as the group action with SL2R as the group, acting on the space of dual numbers given by RP. The Iwasawa decomposition of SL2R played a very important role. We saw that the subgroup N defined shifts and subgroup A defined dilations, but it was the K subgroup which gave us a geometry to work with. We also studied isotropy subgroup of the dual unit epsilon, and we found various results related to the conjugation, the points and fixes, and we also described its orbit. Also, Möbius action on cycles, which we represented through similarity of matrices via FSC construction, helped us in demonstrating invariance of a cycle under matrix similarity. We also discussed certain practical applications of the isotropy subgroup N dash and its conjugate subgroup N.
You have any questions to speak that? Yes. If there are no questions, let's thank the speaker.